Amenities and it's close. Johnny can bike to work.
Here to work, Katie?
Yeah, it's showing your notes though, so you might want to
display
settings to duplicate when you get to that, okay? Susan, how are you? Oh, you're muted. Hi, Ed.
Yeah, there you go.
The mute, the unmute.
Are we going to get Courtney today, do you think, Katie?
Yes. Yep, she, I know she's planning on attending, it sounds like she's logging on, so. And I'm sure if, it is 5 o'clock, so if you wanted, she says she's on her way, but.
Okay, well, it is 5 o'clock, so let's go ahead, let's see. All right, let me know when we're live.
Okay, I just started the webinar on, the webinar is live. Louis, can you let us know when you have it live?
Yes, we're live on YouTube.
Yep. Well, then let's get kicked off. I'll start by saying hello and welcome to the Capitola Planning Commission special meeting of April 21st, 2022. In accordance with California Senate Bill 361, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Commissioners and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using the Zoom application or a landline or mobile phone, along with how to submit public comments during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, and on the published meeting agenda. As always, this meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV, Channel 8, in the city of Capitola, and on Channel 25 throughout Santa Cruz County. The meeting is being recorded to be rebroadcast the following Monday and Friday at 1 p.m. Meetings can also be streamed live on YouTube or from the city's website. And our technician tonight is, we have one?
Olivia Feely.
Is it Sean? Emily?
Olivia Feely.
Olivia Feely. Thank you, Olivia, for supporting us tonight. With that, let's get on with the roll call. Louis, do you want to give us the roll call?
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Here.
Commissioner Newman.
Here.
Commissioner Roof.
Here.
Commissioner Westman.
Here.
Chair Wilk.
Here. Now we'll move on to oral communications. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda?
No additions or deletions to the agenda. I have to admit, though, I haven't been at my computer for the past couple hours, and I will check to make sure no public comment came.
Okay, because that is the next item on the agenda. Item 2B is public comment. This is the time for the public to weigh in on items that are not on the agenda. So if there's anybody on Zoom who wants to raise your hand and speak on topics that are not on the agenda, now is the time to do so.
It looks like we do not have any attendees on Zoom this evening other than the panelists. And I'm now going to the public comment. And no new public comment not related to this evening's agenda.
Very good. Then we'll move on to commission comments. Do any commissioners wish to speak on items not on the agenda? Seeing no hands raised, I will move on to staff comments. Katie, do we have any staff comments on non-agenda items?
No staff comments on non-agenda items.
Very good. We'll move right on then to item 3, public hearing. These are agenda items, and the first item is item 3A, the ordinance adding chapter 17.82. Staff, you have presentation.
Yes. This evening we have Ben Noble of Ben Noble Planning here. Ben has been working on both our objective standards under the SB2 grant and also helping us with our SB9. So we're going to start with the objective standards for multifamily and mixed-use residential. Ben? That looks good. And you're on mute.
Okay. Thank you, Katie. Good evening. So this item is a draft ordinance
to allow residential development of up to 4 units in the R1 business district. Ordinance to implement recently adopted state law.
Oh.
But
I think the first item that the objective.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Let's try this. Okay. All right. So this item is the draft ordinance to establish new objective standards for multifamily and tonight, staff requests that the planning commission consider forwarding to the city council a positive recommendation that talks about the draft ordinance. So preparing the objective standards has been funded by a state grant intended to help facilitate the increased housing production throughout California. As discussed at the March 31st planning commission meeting, these standards will help to protect the city and ensure quality of development light new state housing policy, including SB 35, Housing Accountability Act, and the city's regional housing needs allocation requirements in the state housing. As the public process to prepare these standards began in early 2021, we had the Planning Commission study session and City Council study session to review project goals and approach. There were two stakeholder meetings in 2021 to receive input on draft standards, and there was a Planning Commission study session on March 31st to receive feedback on these draft standards. The Planning Commission previously reviewed the draft standards at the special meeting on March 31st, 2022, and the Planning Commission input at this meeting included requests to add an intent statement to our circulation streetscape standards, to add landscaping standards if parking is adjacent to the street, and to allow entries that do not face the street. So following the Planning Commission meeting, staff incorporated revised standards into a new chapter in the zoning code. The draft ordinance also includes references to the residential mixed-use and commercial zoning district chapter to the existing standards. The standards would apply to multifamily and mixed-use residential projects in all zoning districts that allow these uses except for the village. So these standards would apply in the RM district, in the MUN district, the community commercial district, the regional commercial district, as shown in the zoning district. So this slide shows the organization of the new zoning code chapter. Within Chapter 1782, Sections 010, 020, and 030 describe the purpose of the standards, where they apply, and how an applicant may request deviation from one of the standards. The standards themselves are found in Sections 040 through 090, which is 6 categories. Preceding the standards in each category is an intent statement. And the Planning Commission may approve deviations to standards through the design permit standard, the design permit process, upon finding that the project incorporates an alternative method to achieve the intent statement that exceeds the standards. So the standards before the Planning Commission tonight are the same as those previously reviewed by the Planning Commission, with a few exceptions. So in the circulation and streetscape sections, we added that the intent of the standards is to promote social engagement along property frontages, along with other intent statements. In the RM and MUN zones, there's new language that would allow for a 4-foot sidewalk instead of a 6-foot sidewalk if the new sidewalk ties in to an existing adjacent 4-foot sidewalk. And within this section, there's also new street tree standards that are consistent with current city practices. Within the parking and vehicle access section, we've added new standards that require perimeter landscaping when parking is located between a building and a street, and that doesn't allowed. These standards include a requirement for a minimum 4-foot planting strip, as well as one tree for every 30 feet of street frontage. Within the building placement orientation and entry section, we've added a requirement for projects without a street-facing primary entry. And these requirements include at least one pedestrian walkway to the interior of the lot from the sidewalk every 50 feet, landscaping requirements between the building and the street, the prohibition of continuous solid fences that might create a wall effect, and a maximum building width standard of no greater than 50 feet. So that's a summary of the revisions to the standards in response to Planning Commission feedback incorporated into the draft ordinance. So staff recommendation is for the Planning Commission to review the draft ordinance and consider forwarding a positive recommendation for the ordinance. So the next step, if the Planning Commission does forward a positive recommendation with no or only minor revision to the ordinance, this will be for the City Council for a hearing on May 12th of 2022. If the Planning Commission recommends major revisions to the ordinance, we would then continue the hearing for a second time before the Planning Commission on May 5th. So with that, that completes the presentation, and we're available for any questions.
All right, are there any questions of staff from the commissioners?
I have one, and I'm trying to find this statement in the proposed ordinance, and I can't offhand, but I'll tell you, it's where it discusses the width of the building, and it says the width shall not exceed 50 feet. It's an item B1, I didn't make it real clear in my notes, but it states that no building shall be more than 50 feet in width, I believe, on the street side. And directly underneath that, about two sentences down, be section B2B, it addresses buildings that exceed 50 feet in width. So I'm not quite sure how you can have a prohibition in one statement and then a couple statements later address buildings that exceed 50 feet. So that was a little confusing. Yeah, there it is, B under standard.
Yeah.
And then,
I think that is a big catch on your part, and it is an error in the ordinance. I think that B1 is old language that should have been removed.
Well,
can't be 50 feet in width then, correct? Or they cannot?
Right. Well, if it exceeds 50 feet in length, it needs to incorporate a prominent recess at intervals of 50 feet left. So it reads more like 50 foot.
Okay, so there's not a prohibition of more than 50 feet then, correct?
Correct. That's an error.
When I read that one section, and I remember that same kind of reaction, one section refers to width and one section refers to length. But I think they both mean the same thing.
Yeah, it's the dimension of the building that's parallel to the street that it's from.
So should that come out in its entirety then?
Yeah, I believe
so. Shouldn't it?
Yeah, the B1 should be.
I have a question that, since we're talking about
language. Oftentimes when you have options presented, like windows and doors, street-facing windows and doors shall comply with one of the following, you get several options. One of the options is, the options will say, like, all street-facing windows and doors must feature build-up profile and framing. And you use that, you know, in other options. Whenever you have an option, there's always one of the options that has the word must in there, and it seems to me that that should just, instead of must, it should be that. Because it's a little confusing to say it's an option and then also have the word must in there. Semantics, something to think about.
You want me to pull it up on the screen then?
Well, I have it up.
No, mixed-use project F, recessed entries must feature design elements, must have open railings, you know, it's an option, but you must have, you know, so just use the word must, and when you're talking about options, it seems to be, there's a better way to say that.
So, see, I'm trying to find, is this within entry design?
I think it's 82-12.
Yeah, that's the page number 8212, and that's just one example. It says windows and doors, 2A.
Oh, yeah.
It happens throughout. You also do it on page 82-8, mixed-use projects, 2F, recessed entries must feature design elements. Same page, residential projects. 1B3 must have open rung railings. So I would just, you know, I would give it a once over and get rid of the must.
So Commissioner Wilk, if we were to make some cases like this where there are options to revise the language in this manner, would this address your comment?
So let me go back to that. So all street facing windows and doors. I gotta close this. Yes. Okay, all streams just that feature bill. Yeah, just get rid of the must. That's if it makes semantic sense. All street facing windows and doors feature build up profile. Yeah, that flows nicely and gets rid of the must. Same with the shall, right?
But that doesn't work. The B doesn't work.
For all street-facing windows, glass,
Is.
And so what we'll do is we'll go through the entire ordinance and take this where the sort of language appears will make some of that.
That'd be great. I think, you know, it's a minor point, but might as well clean it up a little bit. Thank you. Other questions? Okay. There are no more questions to staff. Let's we move on to public comments now. Are there any public comments on this that we're in tonight?
There are no attendees on the Zoom meeting other than the panelists, and there are no public comments in the public comment email.
Okay, so with that, we can then move on to deliberation from the commission. I guess what you're asking us is, do we have minor or major comments on this input? Anybody want to start off with comments? Let me get back to participants so I can see who's raising their hand.
And Chair Wolf, would you like me to continue sharing my screen, or should I stop sharing?
I think sharing, because we'll probably ask you to come back and forth. I'm still playing with my
Okay, so Mick Ruth has his hand up and would like to begin.
Just a comment, because, you know, I've probably been the biggest stickler on the council regarding design, trying to protect the character of our community. And, you know, I'm going to give this ordinance my blessing, because I think it does a good job in that regard.
Okay. Commissioner Westman, you had your hand up for a second.
I think I'm trying to put it up.
There we go.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah,
I agree with Commissioner Ruth. I think that the staff and Mr. Noble have done a nice job on this ordinance. I think it will put in place a lot of design features that will enhance our community in the future, particularly on projects where there's not going to be a lot of discretionary review. So I'm happy with the ordinance how it is.
Very good. Other comments or deliberation concerns? Let's see. I don't see anybody else wanting to chime in. Well, let me. Let me just ask the other commissioners, does your silence indicate consent that you have no further comments and this is acceptable?
This is Commissioner Newman. I'm prepared to move this along to the council with the edits that you suggested, which I think are clean up to get the syntax correct.
All right, so before you make a motion, or if a motion is required, let me dive in, because I don't like it, and I assume that we're going to probably vote in a majority of this, but so let me throw in some minor comments before I make my major concerns. On 8212, which is windows and doors, you have various options. You know, we talk about street-facing windows, glass must be inset 3 inches. I'm suggesting there might be a third option, which is just have windows that open. I'm trying to understand the intent of having these specific window design issues in there, and it occurs to me, well, you just don't want a facade of glass, a flat glass, and so therefore you're saying, oh, you gotta trim it out, you gotta put it in a recess, So it occurs to me that you get the same thing, you could have like a modern design, but the windows open, then you would meet the intent of, okay, now you are, you know, you have a kind of a user-friendly or neighborhood-friendly approach. Is that something that anyone would consider adding as an option?
Well, I have to say, for me personally, I'm actually comfortable with the wording that's in the ordinance, because I think it's important, you know, in this kind of document where you're supposed to have these objective standards, and there will be projects that will be built under these standards that will never come to the Planning Commission. So for me personally, I like having some of that detail in there.
Oh, so I'm just saying, yeah, could we add just one more option, you know, and here are all your different options, and let's just add another option. So, okay, so it's not a recessed window, it's not a framed window, but at least it's a window that opens, you know, let's say someone, I'm sorry?
I said that sounds pretty vague.
Yeah, that was my reaction.
Okay, I withdraw my comment. The other comment I have on a minor issue is having to do with refuse storage areas. I mentioned this before on page 8214, 1B, B1B, I guess, refuse container must be located and have a minimum height of 5 feet for carts and cans and 7 feet for dumpsters. Where did those numbers come from? Ben or Katie?
Yeah, so I would say that those numbers would need to be an appropriate height to fully screen the container.
Because I looked at some of the various enclosures, and it seems to me that 4 feet is plenty for the carts that Green Waste provides, and 6 feet is plenty high for dumpsters. And I guess it's not a huge thing, but other than the fact that I happen to have a 4 foot wall that screens my carts and cans, and the notion that a lower wall can actually be more welcoming. It does screen the cans, but it does seem to be less of a barrier, less of a huge fence. It's something you can rest your elbow on. You know, it's more welcoming. So, again, those numbers just seem to be off to me. Does anybody else care?
I agree there, too. Too large, the numbers, they don't need to be that high.
There's two.
So I'm wondering if we can come up with some wording that, says that the enclosure should be 1 foot above the height of the cans or the dumpsters that they're trying to screen, because dumpsters in particular do come in different sizes. And we don't know in the future exactly what size cans people are going to be using if we suddenly go to, a can that's much shorter, much smaller. The whole idea is just to screen the can. So rather than maybe have a fixed height in there, we say what we want is for it to be screen the cans of the dumpster.
Yeah, I was thinking that we should just do away with any measurements and say screen from public view by a public enclosure, by a solid enclosure.
Yeah, I think that works just as well.
I would agree with that.
Okay, Ben, are you willing to accept that modification?
Something along these lines?
Yeah. Yeah, great. Period. Okay, so thank you very much for that concession. In general, my comments are I'll repeat what I said before and won't go through all the details since everybody else seems to like this approach, but I find it much too prescriptive in terms of specifying numbers, windows, arbors, recesses, you name it, all those things. I would get rid of just a lot of these kinds of details. And I think we could still have the general notion of, dimensions, recesses, but when we get into specific design, there are many areas where I think we just get a little too close. I like the idea of having options, this or that or that or that, but even so, there are, I think, many cases where I think we just get into too much detail. The notion of specifying an arbor or a window in a garage door. It's a garage door, if it's a decent size, I would think that's enough of a specification. But I seem to be in a minority, so I will belabor the issue. Courtney, do you have any comments on the item?
The only thing I really can, everybody hear me?
Yes.
The only thing I really I think that it should be, I mean, I agree with you, Commissioner Wilk, but I do feel like there should be a degree of, you know, description in the ordinance, just because it's never going to be up for discretionary review. So, but I agree with that this seems to be a good outline for the ordinance, and that I especially like all of the mapping diagrams that were included in the agenda, or in the, it just seems to kind of lay it out pretty well.
You're, unfortunately, Courtney, you're encouraging me to speak more by a little bit of encouragement. So, you know, I'm not. I just feel that I'm not going to get any progress going through this page by page, specifying all of my little itty bitty issues. So I think in general it is a good document. It's 80% there, I don't know. I don't need to have any more discussion on this. If someone wants to make a motion, or if anyone else wants to discuss more,
I'll make a motion. But Mr. Chairman, if it's any solace, I believe that this is not going to be very broadly used because of the conditions under which it becomes applicable. So I don't think you need to worry too much about it. I think we have to enact it, but I don't think it's going to take over the city's planning process.
All right.
I agree.
And I will move that we recommend this to the City Council with minor editing changes that the Commissioner suggested earlier on, that the Chairman suggested.
I'll second again. I thought your first comment was the motion.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Newman and a second by Commissioner Root to approve the document with minor adjustments as noted. Could we have a roll call? Well, is there any further discussion on the motion or clarifications or amendments?
I have one question, just real fast. I apologize, I should have brought this up earlier, but there's two inquiries on the agenda are asking for direction, and I'm wondering am I missing this part where 17 is on page 3 of our agenda?
That's the next item.
Sorry. I apologize. Thank you for the second.
I also got confused on that earlier, so it's very, very messy. So we have a motion and a second. Can we have a roll call vote, Louis?
Sure. Commissioner Christensen.
Aye.
Commissioner Newman.
Aye.
Commissioner Roof.
Aye.
Commissioner Westman.
Aye.
Chair Wilk.
No. Okay, motion passes. 4-1. With that,
thank you.
Move on to item D, which is SB9 ordinance. We have that presentation.
Yeah, I will be doing that again. So let me first. The title slide visible?
Yes.
Great. Okay. So the second item tonight is a hearing on the draft ordinance that implements SB9 that would allow for residential development up to 4 units within the R1 zoning district. So this ordinance would implement recently adopted state law known as SB9. Staff requests that the Planning Commission consider forwarding to the City Council a positive recommendation to adopt the draft ordinance. So as we discussed at the March 31st, 2022 meeting, SB9, which went into effect of January this year, requires all cities and counties in California to allow 2 dwelling units on a parcel within a single-family zone if the development meets certain requirements. SB9 also requires cities to allow an urban lot split within a single family zone, with two units allowed on each side to meet a single parcel. So if you do an urban lot split on an existing parcel to create two parcels, you can have two units on each of those parcels for a total of four units on the original parcel. SB9 does allow cities to limit the size of these units to 800 square feet and requires that the minimum parcel size for an urban lot split is 1,200 square feet for each newly created parcel. So you must have an existing parcel of at least 2,400 square feet to qualify for an urban lot split. So that's what SB9 requires. Here's a map of all of the R1 zoning districts in Capitola. So the yellow areas are the areas where SB9 applies, and it also applies both within and outside of the coastal zone. The coastal zone boundary is the purple line. Okay, so this item was before the planning commission on March 31st, and at this meeting, the planning commission reviewed models of how up to four units could be accommodated on a typical R1 lot. And so the consensus feedback from commissioners was that for 3 and 4 unit projects on lots less than 5,500 square feet, Capitola should allow up to 3 stories in order to prioritize front yards and to accommodate a shared access drive with on-site parking located for bathrooms. So based on this input, staff revised the draft SB9 ordinance that was previously reviewed by the Planning Commission. And this ordinance includes revisions to both the zoning code and the subdivision zone. So the zoning code, Title 17 of the municipal code, includes a new chapter 1775, SB9 residential development, that contains the rules and procedures for developing SB9 units. There's also an amendment to the ADU ordinance that would prohibit an ADU on an urban lot split parcel with two units. So the ordinance for the planning tonight also includes a new chapter within the subdivision ordinance with regulations and procedures that apply to urban lot split under SB9. There's also a new urban lot split definition to the definition section of the district. So the new SB9 development chapter in the building code contains standards for projects on lots 5,500 square feet or more, as well as standards for lots that are less than 5,500 square feet. We found that lot size is the breaking point where development becomes more constrained and different standards need to be applied. So the good news is that for SB9 projects on lots 5,500 square feet or more, that many of the priorities that the Planning Commission previously expressed can be accommodated. So as shown in this model and on the text on the screen, the draft ordinance for lots 5,500 square feet or more would limit buildings to a maximum height of 2 stories, with 20 feet at the face height and an additional 2 feet for a pitch roof. 3-story buildings would not be allowed on lots 5,500 square feet or more. In terms of setback, we're able to require a minimum 15-foot front setback, with other setbacks such as the rear and interior side at 4 feet. And on lots 5,500 square feet or more, we're also able to require parking located behind the street fronting building with one single driveway, providing for shared access to parking that is located. So, and then also for maximum unit size, with a project that has two units, there's the allowance for 1,200 square feet per unit, whereas a project with 3 to 4 units on a lot of 1,500 square feet, 500 or more, the maximum size would be 800 square feet per unit. And the reason we've done that is just to encourage and incentivize a two-unit project rather than a 3 or 4 unit project, because a two-unit project would be more compatible with the existing structure. So for S9 projects on lots less than 5,500 square feet, the ordinance establishes different standards for projects with 2 units, 3 units, and 4 units. So on the screen right now are the standards that would apply to a 2-unit project on lots less than 5,500 square feet. And so on a 2-unit project, we're able to require no more than 2 stories. We're also able to require a minimum front setback of 15 feet, as well as parking located behind the street-facing dwelling unit to provide for a landscape front setback there. So on a 2-unit project, the standard would require a project that looks something like this. On a 3-unit project, on a smaller lot, development becomes more constrained. And one of the concessions we need to make in order to accommodate 3 800-square-foot units is to allow greater height. In this case, for a 3-unit project, what we're saying is that you can have a 2.5-story project where your third story is built into your roof element. So you have a plate height of 20 feet for your first 2 stories, and then you have a maximum height of your roof at 33 feet with floor area allowed in that roof element. So that's a way to accommodate 3 stories, but within a building form that may read more like a 2-story building in the street. Also, in order to accommodate 800 square foot units on these 3 800 square foot units on these smaller lots, we do reduce the minimum front setback to 10 feet in order to allow for 3 units to be located on. And then, so the ordinance also establishes standards for 4 units on lots less than 5,500 square feet. And these are the lots, or these are the projects where development is the most constrained, and where a number of concessions need to be made in order to accommodate 4 800 square foot units. And based on Planning Commission feedback at the last meeting, what the ordinance says is that parking needs to be interior, and it needs to be accessed from one driveway and one curb cut. But you can have up to 3 stories and buildings located at the sidewalk with a 0 foot setback. And this is obviously not a altogether satisfactory design scenario from a neighborhood compatibility standpoint, but SB9 does require cities to allow up to 4 800 square foot units, and on smaller lots, this is sort of the design scenario that is, I think, that we have consensus of least objectionable. It's quite possible that a project like this would never come forward on a smaller lot, but if it does, these would be the standards.
Question on that, if I can interrupt. So on this particular view, you're showing the parking in the rear, but the there's zero setback on the sidewalk. And I thought that those are the two things we wanted, was parking, you know, more parking, and but also the setback. So why did you sacrifice the setback for parking?
So on a small lot, it is not possible to provide for interior parking and maintain a front setback. It just doesn't.
Right, so you have to choose one or the other, and I would have chose setback over the parking.
Yeah, I think that my recollection is that it was not a unanimous position among all planning commissioners, but there was consensus and a majority of commissioners that preferred this scenario over one where there are four parking spaces located between the building and the street.
I agree with Commissioner Wilk on this one.
Amazing.
Yeah, so an alternative for four-unit projects on these smaller lots is to require the setback with surface parking located between the buildings. That was one of the sort of other options that the planning commission was presented with.
At the right, we have no Hollywood parking, the Hollywood South, we'd have the strip, so it has some sense of landscaping. So at least there's two of us who would prefer that option rather than this one. We need to take a straw poll.
Well, Chair Wilk, I think Commissioner Westman may have her hand up.
Oh, I'm sorry. I couldn't see the hand because I had the flip screen thing up. Okay, Commissioner Westman, go ahead.
Hey, before I get into the parking versus front yard discussion, I actually have a question for Ben. When you showed us the three-unit project on the lots less than 5,500 square feet, for them to be able to put the third story in the roof, we end up with a height of 33 feet. And when we look at the four units, and we just do a standard three-story, we end up, the way I read it, with a height of 31 feet, because it's 28 for the plate and then 3 feet for the roof?
Yes.
So, I was sort of wondering if on the three-unit one, the 33 feet could be a bit less. So we would end up with 31 feet on both of them? Or was it decided that the pitch of the roof needed to be steeper to get the rooms in there? Or?
Yeah, so that's a number that Harry Bottomley developed for us, and he's unfortunately not here tonight. And I think the reason he came up with, or he arrived at 33 feet is that he determined that that was necessary in order to accommodate the 800 square foot.
Okay. If he could just look at that one more time and sort of check that out, it would be nice if it could be a foot or two lower. But on the four unit one, for me, having a curb cut the entire frontage of the building and cars parked in front of it, I don't think aesthetically works for the neighborhood. It eliminates more on-street parking in these neighborhoods where parking is usually at a premium anyway. So I prefer the four-unit design that's being proposed in this ordinance.
Mr. Weston, can you clarify what you just said? Which one are you preferring?
The one that's being presented to us tonight, because if we try and have a front setback, the only way, my recollection is from the last meeting, the only way that works is to have four cars parked in front of the building. Which means that, basically almost all of the building frontage is going to have to be a curb cut to accommodate all of those driveways rather than the approach that we have here.
Thank you for clarifying. I agree with Commissioner Weston on that point. And also I had a different question for all of your mapping diagrams have a pitched roof. Including the three units. diagram that you just showed us with the 33-foot height limit. I'm either forgetting or didn't read that there is any option for flat roof, if there is. Somebody does come in with an option for a flat roof. Does that, do they have other limitations for how high their plate height can be?
So a flat roof would be allowed and it would be limited to 28-foot plate height.
Okay, so that it would just be capped off with the plate height and there wouldn't be an allowance for a roof pitch. And that just would be just kind of, the 3 feet would just be eliminated.
Correct.
Okay, and then for the other one, that's the 33-foot height for the three unit on a smaller lot. If they are proposing a flat roof in this circumstance, that would be a 20-foot plate height, but that would make it pretty impossible to get three units, a three-story building with legitimate living space in there. How would you say that would work?
Right, so a full three-story building under these standards just would not be allowed. If you want three stories of house of living space, it would need to be in this.
Okay, so it would have to be pitched, it have to be dormers, it would have to have all those basically this exact deck. okay, that was my question. And I do agree with Commissioner Westman, just to double back on that, with the parking in the front of with the giant curb cut. My experience with multi-family housing, it seems that having so much parking in the front just alienates the neighborhood from the unit. And even though the diagram that we're being presented shows, you know, the mass of the structure being right up against the sidewalk, I still think that's better than having cars there. So that's my thinking with that.
Commissioner Ruth, do you have your hand up again?
Yeah, I don't agree with Commissioner Westman or Commissioner Christensen. If you could imagine, you know, we're talking the smaller lots now. Most of these lots are 40 by 80. Most of those lots exist in the Jewel Box and other parts, Riverview Terrace and that part. You know, just think, most of the houses in those areas are single-story cottage-type houses. There's a smattering of second-story houses in there. But just imagine for a moment a three-story unit right up to the sidewalk next to one of those cottage-style houses. Even when you're in your front yard, you're blocked off from any light and air almost because you've got this thing looming up only 4 feet from your front yard, 33 feet in the air. I just think if you look at this diagram, the way that driveway is accessed, there's no room for additional cars on either side of that driveway. So you're not eliminating any on-street parking by allowing parking across the whole frontage because this design eliminates any on-street parking the way it's configured. So I just think it just makes the neighborhood more livable, more just a nicer place to live. You don't have a 30-foot structure right up on the sidewalk. I'd much prefer to see parking in the front. I live across the street from one of those with parking in the front. It doesn't present any problems at all. But if that building were 32 feet tall right up to the sidewalk, it would just really ruin the neighborhood. So I can't support this aspect of it.
Mr. Weston, you have a rebuttal?
Well, my concern is that we have areas where we have parking in front. You know, go up on, 4648th Avenue and those areas, and, it's continued to be a problem of how do we improve the situation on those streets. I could have a compromise position where perhaps, there's no reason that we have to have only one option for four units on lots less than 5,500 square feet. And, you know, I could live with the idea that we could have two options here, and one would be this design, or the other one would be parking in front, as long as the parking in front was on parking strips, not just a paved area in front of the building. So my suggestion would be perhaps, you know, since this is such a difficult situation, maybe we come up with two options for the four units on lots less than 5,500 square feet.
And Chair Wolf, we do have the different options that we'll share with the Planning Commission at the last meeting available if it is able to look at those. I also do want to point out that there's more in the presentation for me to complete. If you would like me to.
I'm sorry we kind of shanghaied you in the middle of the presentation. But I would like to get, since we seem to be split on this, with the setback issue on this particular slide, I was hoping that I could hear from Commissioner Newman as to which side he weighs in on.
Okay,
on the setback versus the parking.
Yeah, I mean, this kind of brings to the front the difficulty in what we're doing here and how there's pressure on our development standards from all different directions. And you know, in a way, this is just a harbinger of what's to come as the housing needs and the pressure from the state to liberalize housing rules continues. We're going to have to start to prioritize what's most important to us. We're not going to be the same Capitola 20 years from now that we are now, and we aren't the same that we were 20 years ago, where everything was a bungalow, single story. So all of us have to think about what we're willing to give in on, whether it's setbacks, whether it's parking, whether it's height. In my case, I think we're going to have to start to give up on the idea that houses have to be single story or two story and 22 feet high, and we're going to have to start going upwards. I don't see any other long-term solution to that. I don't think having two options, as Commissioner Westman suggested, really helps the other commissioners' concerns at all, because it just leaves it up to the developer as to whether to violate the Commissioner Ruth's concern or not. So that doesn't really solve the problem. If I have to come down on one side or the other, I'm going to come down on the Commissioner Westman and Christensen's view that we should give in on the setbacks in this situation.
Okay. Commissioner Brooks, I'd just like to add one more comment. And
please, go ahead.
I would just venture to guess that if you polled the people in this city, when they stand in their front yard, if they would rather look next door and see a car or two or three cars parked there and be able to view down their street or to look at a wall, I think they'd choose the latter. I mean the former. They would choose being able to see some cars there and look over the cars and see down the street. That's my final comment on this.
Well, I agree. Other comments? I see a couple of hands still up. I don't know if the residual hands or more comments. Go ahead,
yeah.
Mr. Weston.
Oh, no, I just forgot to lower my hand.
Go ahead,
Court.
Has anybody else noticed that there hasn't been any public attendance at either one of these meetings? I just, seeing that this seems like a pretty significant proposal for a change.
Because SB9 is under the radar.
Right. It just seems a little strange that there wouldn't be any public comments.
Well, it's not really clear how meaningful it's going to end up being for Capitola, how many people are going to want to subdivide their small R1 lots in Capitola and build four units on them.
Right. But, a developer might?
They might.
I
we don't know that yet, whether that's going to we might be just wasting our time.
So I'm going to butt in here a little bit. So we have this, you know, option one and two that's been presented to us tonight about areas where that are going to be exempt from having these kinds of subdivisions take place based on input that we've gotten from the Coastal Commission. So it seems to me that when you look at that map, a lot of the really small lots that we look at in Riverview Terrace or, you know, up on Depot Hill or in parts of the Jewel Box, certainly if we go with option two, these standards aren't going to apply there. Is that correct? I mean, that's the way I'm reading it.
So I think that's a good lead into the rest of the presentation, but...
All right, why don't we go ahead and finish the presentation then, and we can circle back to any open issues.
But that, just to be clear, that standard is for areas that would not be allowed to utilize the parking exception.
Okay.
Ben?
Great. Okay. So as I mentioned previously, SB9 applies within the coastal zone, but there is language within the statute that SB9 shall not be construed, supersede, or in any other way alter or lessen the effect of application of the California Coastal Zone. So that's the same language that is included in state law relating to ADUs. What that means is that cities that have areas within the coastal zone need to find ways to harmonize the requirements of SB9 with the requirements of the Coastal Act, as well as their certified LCC. So one of the ways in which this ordinance aims to accomplish that is to prohibit SB9 projects in certain areas within the coastal zone, specifically within mapped areas of geological hazards, flood hazards, and environmentally sensitive habitat areas. So here's a map that's showing the boundaries of the geologic hazard area as it's currently mapped. Here's a map showing the flood hazard areas currently. And then here are the environmentally sensitive habitat. And so, looking at all three of these maps, most of these areas are not zoned R1, and SB9 does not apply there. But there are some R1 areas adjacent to the so-called creek and on Prospect Avenue where SB9 projects would not be allowed. But it's limited geographically in terms of where SB9 prohibitions would apply. But it is also true that these maps will change over time, particularly to expanded areas subject to coastal hazards resulting from sea level rise.
Is Prospect Avenue defined as a coastal bluff?
It is not.
No. So I think this is the area that I'm referring to.
It's included in the geological hazard area, but it is not a coastal bluff. We looked at that with the recent application of 1410 process.
Okay, and then so parking is another issue that overlaps with the Coastal Act and the LCC, because the Coastal Act includes policies that cities must maintain and enhance public access to the shoreline. So under SB9, cities cannot require more than one off-street space per unit, and then also can't require any parking within 1/2 mile walking distance of a high-quality transit corridor or a major transit stop. And so there are definitions for a high-quality transit corridor, and currently there are none in Capitola, though there may be some in the future, or a major transit stop. And so, as I said previously, the SB 9 statute includes language that allows for cities to deviate from requirements in SB 9 if it's necessary to conform with the Coastal Act or the certified LCP. So for that reason, we have included language that would always require at least one parking space in certain areas where that exception in cases of proximity to a major transit corridor or transit hub would not be available. And there are two areas that were mapped that are before the Planning Commission as options. Option one are the area of the most parking impacted areas in Depot Hill and close to the Village and Riverview Terrace neighborhoods. And then option two expands that to include more Riverview Terrace neighborhood and portions of the Jewel Box. And so it is sort of a little bit confusing because it's essentially a double negative. This map is showing areas where the parking exception would not apply. So it's a little bit hard to follow, but really what this is saying is that in either the gray or the blue area, at least one parking space would always be required without the ability to receive or to benefit from an exception from that parking space requirement. So we're looking for Planning Commission feedback on this, particularly if the option one area or the option two blue area.
Okay.
I see there's a hand up.
Yeah, I have my hand up. Yeah. Commissioner Ruth. When you look at this map, most of the Jewel Box area that's in blue is in closer proximity to beach access than most of Depot Hill. And so I disagree with the way this map is configured. Also, Depot Hill has permit parking, which the Jewel Box area doesn't. And the parking impacts in the Jewel Box are much greater than the parking impacts in Depot Hill. So I don't think the map prioritizes the areas properly. And I think that needs to be discussed in depth.
Commissioner Newman? Are they parking as much as we can? And I think I'm sort of agreeing with Commissioner Ruth as far as the Jewel Box is concerned. I think we should include option two as well as option one as areas where the parking requirements are in effect.
So I'm a little confused here. Ben, are you done with your presentation?
I am almost done. I have three thoughts.
Let's let Ben finish.
So I do want to pause here for 1 second, Ben, I'm sorry. But in the staff report, I had written that we were asking the Planning Commission to decide between option one or option two. What I meant to draft was between option one and option one and two together.
Right.
Point of clarification. Thank you. Ben.
Thanks, Katie. Okay, and then so one minor cleanup, provided that the Planning Commission recommends including this provision within the ordinance. Commissioner Newman pointed out that there was a little cleanup that was needed in the language to make sure that what was written was actually what we meant. And so we would recommend modifying the language in this provision so that it is clear what is intended. So that's shown on the screen. Okay, and then the last item that we're requesting feedback on, there's language in the draft ordinance that I think has been in the ordinance for a while, including in prior versions that were reviewed by the Planning Commission, requiring a separate utility connection for each dwelling unit on a lot. This is not a requirement that is mandated by SB 9, and so we're interested in Planning Commission feedback on whether or not this requirement should remain or be removed. And so with that, staff recommendation is for the Planning Commission to consider forwarding a positive recommendation to the City Council to adopt the ordinance. And just like with the objective standard, if the Planning Commission recommends adoption with minor revisions, it can move forward to the City Council for a hearing on May 12th. If the Planning Commission directs staff to prepare major revisions to the ordinance, we would take that back to the Planning Commission for the second hearing that would occur on May 5th of 2022. And so with that, I will end my presentation.
Katie, do you want to go ahead and talk about what specifically you want, which topic you want to address first?
Let's start with the really easy one, I think, of the utilities. So I think in our ADU ordinance, we required separate hookups for, and that, I think that was straight from the state law. And under this, there is no requirement for the utility connections to be individuals. They could tie into the same utilities on the same lot. It's a cost savings to applicants. And would love to hear your feedback.
Let's start with Commissioner Newman.
So that's an easy one for me. I support keeping it the way it is. Those of us who remember the old days when Commissioner Ruth was just a little boy, apartments used to be master metered, so they would have one utility connection for an apartment, and that is no longer done because it turns out that there's a huge increase in utility usage when the individual users are not specifically charged for their usage. And so nobody in their right mind would ever build an apartment building now that is master metered. And the same philosophy, I think, applies to these smaller subdivisions.
Mr. Westman?
I agree with Commissioner Newman.
Commissioner Newman, maybe that's the key to discouraging developers from building these units if we require them to be master metered.
Well, we should for just conservation reasons.
I also tend to agree with Commissioners Newman and Weston, and it seems to me that if we want to encourage multiple families and not to have these units turn into communes or whatever, we would want to have separate utilities for that very reason, so that you could easily rent them out separately. Commissioner Christensen, do you have any?
Yeah, I was just on the sheer fact, I mean, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but they are available to be sold separately. Is that right?
Yeah.
Not within the same lot. So when you subdivide them, each lot can be sold individually,
right,
but the two units per lot cannot be sold.
Okay. I would be leaning towards keeping it separately metered, each unit.
So you need a vote on this, Katie?
Oh, you know what? I think we forgot to vote public hearing, so.
Oh, we did. I'm sorry. That's my fault. do we have any public comment?
So checking public comment. There is no written public comment. And I did notice this twice in the paper, so there is no attendance.
to the commission. Again, let me ask the question, do you want us to formally vote on this, or do you have your feedback?
I think that was consensus to keep the separate utility connection, so we can move on.
Yeah, if there's a motion, we'll want to make sure that this is, well, actually, we're not making any change to the draft ordinance, so that would not need to be requested in the motion.
Right, okay. So we won't do a motion.
And now if we can go to the map then. So here's an image of the map. I do want to clarify that originally, so Depot Hill, the unique factor of Depot Hill is that it is all within the appeal zone for Coastal Commission. So that was one thing we took into consideration when drafting this map. But I definitely hear and understand Commissioner Ruth's concern. In the jewel box, it is overparked, and that's why we included it in the option two. I also want to say you're welcome to create a third option if you think that we should include the rest of the jewel box, but maybe not include the neighborhood near New Brighton Middle School. You know, it's up to you. We have Sean here making these maps. He's going to amend it based on your direction. So these were, you know, option one and then option one and two combined, but you are also free to give us other guidance and we'll modify the map.
Let me ask a question of clarification. So what you're asking is these areas that are marked in either blue or gray are basically creating a more restrictive parking requirement. In other words, you have to have at least one off-site parking unit. So if we want more off-site parking and more, and as a result, more curb parking, the more areas we include, the better off we are. That's the idea.
Yes, but it has to be in harmony with the Coastal Act. So it really has to have, the areas that we put into this map should really tie into areas in which the public could park, you know, to walk down to the beach. So we wouldn't want to include everything all the way to Clare Street. I think that wouldn't pass muster, but really those areas that are really close, you know, close to the beach and that the public may park at in order to go to the beach.
So we don't, we have the city split into two sections, the coastal zone and the non-coastal zone, so couldn't we include the entire coastal zone?
We could, but it may be, I could see the Coastal Commission saying we didn't mean for it to go that far, but you're welcome to, you could provide that direction. Right now, as it stands, the two exemptions that exist, one is for car share, so if the development came in and some other reason to get a local car share, they could utilize the exemption. The other one is for any transportation that has 15-minute intervals. Right now, Capitola doesn't have any of those, so right now no one is subject to the exceptions, but over time, as more housing comes in, hopefully our metro follows and there'll be more stops, so then at that point, the areas in the map would be required to provide parking.
Okay, Commissioner Ruth, you have your hand up.
Then just a question, so if we combine option one and option two, is that something the Coastal Commission will accept?
I believe so. I think that's easily walkable in areas that people do utilize to get down to the village and the beach.
Okay. I think that's the way we should go then.
Did we want to include any additional areas? You were suggesting perhaps more of the jewel box?
The entire jewel box is included.
Oh, okay.
Well, yeah, there's two, not all the way, really. Well, I guess it is. But I think the Upper Village part is a little bit of a stretch in terms of parking for coastal access, but I don't see any reason not to include it if we can get away with it.
Yeah, and it has really severe parking issues.
tend to agree as well to do options one and two. Does anybody, other commissioners, want to weigh in? Seems to be the consensus so far.
Yeah, I agree with one and two.
Okay. Again, do you want a you want a motion on this, or are you happy with just verbal consensus, Katie?
I think we can tie that in at the end with the final motion. So I will. I'm taking notes of what to add to the motion. So I've got include one and two for the parking. Okay, and now the discussion on four units on a smaller lot. I do want to quickly share my screen just to bring up a couple of images. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
So the image you're seeing here is the 40 by 80 lot, and actually on a 40 by 80 lot, the 3,200 square feet, we are able to squeeze in, I think it's a 4 foot, say, front yard. It's a 5 foot setback, and, but as we get smaller, go to the next, this is a 40 by 70 lot, which is what Ben was showing in his presentation. At that point, under option B, there's a 0 foot setback. And when we had this discussion with Planning Commission last, we looked at these options in between A, with all the parking in the front, versus B. I think there was a majority that leaned towards B. However, we, once you're, you know, larger than at a 40 by 80, which is a typical lot size in Capitola, just wanted to, there is the ability to have a 5 foot setback within that area. So, and I think by code, we're requiring a 4 foot setback, but understanding that it's going to be a give and take once, depending on the lot size. So I'll stop sharing, and with that, we'll have discussion.
So it seems like during the discussion we had a 3-2 majority sacrificing front yardage for parking. So Nick and I both were emphasizing the largest setback, but we are in a minority.
So we can just tell, I mean, we're just passing it on to the council, and they'll make the final ruling on that, and they can know that this was a split decision.
Yeah.
Commissioner Ruth, do you have your hand up?
Yeah, and in the staff report portion of the SB9 item under discussion, it's under the discussion part, there's some bullets, and under that second bullet, it said the allowance of the number of units allowed is guaranteed regardless of setback. So I'm curious how that statement equates to us even requiring setbacks.
So we can require them if they'll fit, but if they won't fit, so somebody comes in with a 40 by 70 lot, and they can have the four 800 square foot units on the lot, but if they don't, they're not required to meet the setbacks. Whereas if they were on a 5,500 square foot lot, and we now have proof that you can build your 800 square foot unit, your four 800 square foot units, and comply with our setback. So you're it's just a guaranteed allowance. So no matter what, they get the 800 square feet.
Okay, so again, it seems like it is a 3-2 preference with the presentation as then presented it. A street level frontage.
Okay, and then there was one more edit that Ben showed in in his presentation for parking and just rewording that, those two sections within the lot split and the FB9 to reference that map correctly. Are there any other sections of code you'd like to discuss? Any other amendments?
Mr. Chairman, I have a few sort of nitpicks that if we're at that point, I'd like to throw out there.
Go ahead.
So I'll go through the ordinance. I think I just have about four of them, and only one of them is really substantive. The first one is 16.78.040A1. And that is in connection with a lot split application. The requirement that the applicant submit a title report that's less than 30 days old doesn't really accomplish what you want to accomplish, because you could have a 30-day-old title report that doesn't convey the current situation. So I would recommend changing that language to read a title report showing the current ownership and all current liens and encumbrances 30 days old. Then on that same section, 16.78.040A3D. I thought I raised this, but this is really picky, but is there any reason why only a survey by a licensed land surveyor and not also a civil engineer is? Because we have another place where you have either. Normally, civil engineers are qualified to do that.
That's correct.
Then, this one's really picky. This is a 16.78.060 A, the fourth line down. I think width should be which.
Am I in the right place here?
Yeah, fourth line down, A. Containing reference to a deed under which the property was acquired by the current owner.
That should be which. And now, for the one that is substantive, which is, or it's really a question on my part, I think I just don't understand it, which is, 17.75040 G, which is on page 4 of 9, all the way down to G. 2, and the guaranteed allowance of 800 square feet of floor area is in addition to the maximum floor area of a property in the R1 zoning district. I guess I should be able to understand that, but I can't. Does that mean if the floor area ratio allows for a certain number of square feet, you can have 800 more?
Correct.
Wow.
Okay. So that would apply if there were, we can almost remove that because it's covered in other areas, but if there were an existing single family home that was, you know, they're protected as well under FB9. But I think that can be removed, that carryover actually from our ADU ordinance. Ben, do you think that's necessary to keep, or? Because I think we're very specific with allowances of 800 square feet.
I think with paragraph one, that covers that.
Yeah, well, that would make me feel good because I still can't understand it. Thank you. That's all.
Any other comments on the ordinance paragraph from other commissioners? Well, let me see my getting my participants back up. I see no other hands up. So how do we want to handle this, Katie? We've gotten a lot of comments. Some not 100% agreement on all of them.
So I think we understand the consensus on this. We will bring to the city council the split votes and let them know that there was not complete consensus. And if you're ready, we could take a motion to planning commission or to the city council. I do have one additional item that Planner Sasanto brought to my attention. And we don't define how we say 800 square feet throughout the document. Throughout the rest of the zoning code, we talk about floor area, and there's a lot of exceptions to what's included and what is not included in floor area. So I do think it would be helpful. I don't think the way that this has been drafted that any of those exceptions to floor area would be applicable to the SB9 ordinance, and we should probably add some reference to that, unless the Planning Commission would like the exceptions to floor area to be applicable to the SB9 ordinance. So thank you, Sean, for that catch, and it's a very important point. So an example would be an 800 square foot home on three stories, the staircase is only counted once. Another example would be a 800 square foot SB9 project with a second story deck. Where we're changing it to count towards the floor area in the future, the deck, that would not be counted. Sean, do you want to give any other examples? Or I can pull up the code.
Basically whether or not we want to put some exceptions into the 800 square feet, basically allowing them even more square footage effectively, or to insist that the exceptions, by removing the exceptions, you would limit the 800 square feet to something less. Right?
Correct. It would include all square footage.
So it would include the
all area.
Include the stairs. It would include.
And I'm pulling up the floor area exceptions.
I have it up too.
Oh, do you? You want to share then? Yes, this is exactly it. So it includes all interior area balloons and lower roof from within. It includes all entire area in an enclosed structure without deduction of features such as interior walls or storage. There's the example about the staircase only having one. Number four is interior areas of the building with a floor to ceiling height of greater than 16 feet is counted twice. And then scroll down, floor dwelling features, number five, can you scroll up a little? Are included in floor area, the upper floor area greater than 4 feet in height, measured from between the bottom of the upper floor and the top of the ceiling. So that would be applicable to the 2.5 story scenario, and then also all accessory structures other than a single building, one in, of 120 square feet or less. And then number six are features that are excluded from floor area calculation, and that's covered and uncovered decks and patios, trellises. So this whole list under number six, I think that's what we want to specify whether or not to include within our floor area calculation. Right now these are exceptions, and for bay windows, trellises, to 250 square feet of an enclosed garage on the 2,500 square foot lot.
Does state law address this at all, how we define square footage?
It does not. So we can say it's just a gross floor area without any of the exceptions under.
Well, if we want to, if we don't want to really encourage this SB9 evolution here, then we wouldn't want to have any exceptions.
Well, that I don't know if that will necessarily discourage it. It would just, I mean, it would decrease the living, the actual press, the living space significantly, right? I mean, it would control the massing, but it would definitely, I mean, have you ever seen a 200 square foot studio? It's pretty, I mean, you're going to start counting all the stretches of stairs and all the trellises and all the, you know, that I feel like it will start to make pretty unrealistic living space. But I understand what you're saying, Commissioner.
Commissioner Westman?
I would be in favor of not having any exceptions to the 800 square feet. I think that, you know, these are, we don't want the buildings to end up being any bigger than 800 square feet because they're going to be so crowded on these lots anyway. So I would like to see no exceptions.
I would agree with Commissioner Westman and Newman.
And I would as well. Courtney, you disagree?
I don't necessarily disagree. I'm taking into consideration really how much, you know, it's going to be a really small living space. And I guess that's really what discourages this type of development. But it just seems like such a, I'm trying to practically, you know, visualize it in my head. So I guess I would be in support of saying no exception.
Okay, sounds like you have a consensus, Katie.
Okay, so I'm hearing combined parking 1 and 2 and to remove any floor area exceptions within the SB9 ordinance and to include the edits by Commissioner.
So I'll make a motion including the items that Katie just mentioned to move this forward.
So a motion to move this forward to the
City Council.
City Council with
the three items that Katie mentioned, the no exceptions, including areas, options 1 and 2, and to include the edits made by Commissioner Newman.
But to also basically to include our Planning Commission's split votes or comments as, because really, okay, all you're asking for is that, do you want to move this forward to the City Council, or do we want to debate more, right? It's just, do we want to move it forward, yes or no?
Sure, or if you have other things you want to study, we're happy to.
Okay, so Susan, is that your motion? Your motion is to move it forward?
Including the items that we have discussed tonight.
I second that. We have a motion by Commissioner Westman and a second by Commissioner Newman. Any further discussion?
Can I ask one last question? Katie, I can't remember, but is the garage counted as, do they have to have covered parking? I can't, within that one parking space that needs to be provided. To clarify, it's an easy reference.
Yeah. Covered parking is not required, and the other thing is that there the exception to including a garage towards the square footage has now been removed, so there's no exception for garages.
Okay.
So in essence, if we're suggesting that there are no exceptions and they're going to maximize the amount of FAR that they're going to be proposing, there's essentially nobody's going to propose covered parking because they're going to use that square footage to then put inside for usable living space.
Okay.
And I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page. Is that something that you would want to? Okay, just making sure.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. With, if there's no more further comments or questions, Louis, could we have a roll call vote?
Sure. Commissioner Christensen?
Aye.
Commissioner Newman?
Aye.
Commissioner Ruth?
I think there's just too many things detrimental to the livability of our community, so I'm a no.
Commissioner Westman?
Aye.
Chair Wilk.
Aye. Motion passes 4-1. You, I guess, are authorized now to present this and move this forward to City Council. With that, we can move on to the director's report.
Okay, I have two updates for you. The first is that at the City Council meeting next week, we will be discussing the outdoor dining. The current temporary program. At this point, the Coastal Commission staff were still discussing major points in our draft ordinance. It was originally scheduled to be heard by the Coastal Commission in April, but it does not look like it will be resolved before the May 31st expiration. So that a discussion is going to City Council next week on outdoor dining and continuance of the program. The staff report will be printed tomorrow. And then also in terms of the prototype design for outdoor dining, we're going to host a Zoom meeting with the restaurants to get their feedback. I'm going to be sending out a letter to the restaurants tomorrow about the City Council meeting, and I'll also inform them about a prototype design meeting that's going to be held on May 11th. And that's just so we can get some feedback from the restaurant owner prior to this coming, that once the prior to any coastal development permit coming forward to Planning Commission to understand their needs and desires.
Yes, Zoom meetings are we encouraged to attend?
You know, it's really a meeting for the restaurant owner. So the link will be on our website publicly, but I'm not encouraging you to attend. We'll report back on what we hear and when that comes forward for a coastal development permit. So those are the two items. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Brooks, I just have a quick question for Katie regarding the design of the platforms. I know we're going to make them level with the top of the curb, but I was down there, I was looking at the crown in the road. And if those things extend out the length of the parking spot, in some areas that crown will not allow that to happen and have that platform be level.
I'll raise that concern with the landscape architect, but I do hear what you're saying.
Yeah, okay.
Are there other commission communications, final communications?
I have something. The Art and Cultural Commission is interested in the parklet thing, or the whole
outdoor dining area.
Thank you. I don't know why I blanked on the whole thing. They want to do some type of collaboration, so I forwarded all the prior documents for our last commission meeting to Larry. And to just start maybe a conversation where we could, you know, start relaying messages back and forth to some type of beautification. That's all I have to report.
I have a comment since you brought up the Art and Cultural Commission. And that is, I'm also a member of the Environmental Committee, and they're interested in what the Art and Cultural Commission is doing on Rispin Park. And specifically would like to participate in any signage, environmental environmental signage and environmental activities that would be associated with that. So you might get some outreach from the Environmental Commission soon.
Okay.
Okay, are there any other commission communication? If not,
I wish Commissioner Ruth's wife, hope she's doing better.
She's in her first day of a new knee.
Congratulations.
It's gonna be a long haul.